This morning we will be continuing our four-week series on the secret mystical teachings of Christ, and I want to welcome those of you that are watching at home throughout the world. We appreciate your interest in gleaming the truths that really can move the essence of our being. To start off with, however, we'd like to start with a healing meditation to take the pressure off of the Christmas season. If you've had a very active last few days with shopping, different things that you have to do, family obligations. So if you would you sit back in your chairs, put both feet flat on the floor, your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable to you. And we'll take a few moments now to close our eyes and to work upon the health of our bodies. I turn away from the world that surrounds me to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To leave the physical world and physical skies behind me for just a few moments, that I may center in on the center of consciousness, the presence of God that exists here within me. And so I move from the outer me to the innermost me, that place of the divine, the inner kingdom of consciousness, the heavenly awareness that here within me, the presence that created me, continues to live as the God of the universe and the God of my being, the God of my mind, the God of my body. And so moment by moment and breath by breath, I yield my body, my mind, and my soul to the innermost essence, that light of God's presence within me, that light may enter into all levels of my mind, sublimating all negativity and trauma into light, and through my mind into my body, sending forth light-giving streams of energy into every one of the millions of cells of my body, from the crown of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. And as that energy enters into each and every cell is rejuvenated, re-energized, and brought into perfect harmony with its reason for existing, brought into perfect harmony with the divine pattern established by God for the perfect health of the body. And so if there be any malfunction in any cell or groupings of cells of my body, the light of God, the indwelling nature's intelligence of the universe here within me, corrects, soothes, heals, adjusts, and I feel a sense of peace, of calm, of serenity throughout the entirety of my body, a state of peacefulness that passeth my mortal understanding and comprehension. For it is the peace of God that all is well throughout my body, my mind, and my soul. Here within myself, all is well. Here within myself, peace abides and exists. For my body is as a temple of the Most High, a temple of God, and that temple has been made clean and whole, has been made secure and healthy, and that God's presence vibrates health through my body, through my mind, and through my soul. For this realization and acceptance of good health and healing, this day and every day of my life, I give thanks to God's presence within me. I let it be so, and so it is. Today we continue with part three of a four-part series dealing with the secret teachings of Christ. And just a very, very quick, brief recap of the first two parts of this series. The establishment that there are two forms of Christianity, one for the outer masses of people and one for the inner people. And I mean that quite literally, the inner people. The inner people meaning those that are ready to experience the divine within themselves. Jesus taught two different levels. He taught one level that was to be left after his resurrection for the people on earth, the people that could not comprehend the subtleties that he taught, which was level two, or the highest level, to his disciples. And so what we're sharing here is the level that was taught to the disciples, which takes it far, far beyond the traditional Christian story. It does not negate Christianity as it's commonly taught. It does not negate anything. It was interesting in Christ's time that he said, I haven't come to destroy the law of the prophets. What has already been religious or spiritual. Instead, I've come to fulfill it, which is to fill in the missing links. But recognizing that he had a limited audience for what he was teaching, he then had to say to them, I teach them in parables, for having ears they hear not. At the same time, he disclosed to the disciples that were with him day in and day out how to make direct contact with the divine, with the kingdom of heaven, because it says in the New Testament, there are many people that have sought to see these things that you've seen and seen them not. It's right in there. But it's not emphasized in traditional Christianity because traditional Christianity is the exoteric, meaning the outer presentation of Christ's message. So Christ was different than Buddha, different than Krishna, different than other master teachers that had come to the earth, or messianic type teachers, because he had two messages for those that could understand and those that couldn't understand. Because the Western world needed to get back to center, because Judaism at that time had disintegrated to the worship of the golden calf. It was more outer. It had left the Essene mysteries, which was the particular Jewish cult that Jesus traveled within, and it was an attempt to reestablish that mysticism to Judaism. Because Judaism then was to become the hallmark, or to become the foundation of what we later on have inherited as Christianity. So taking those steps under consideration and bearing that in mind, I also pointed out that practically the entirety of the New Testament is something that most even theologians skip by because they're more in the exoteric, the outer Christianity, and that is that the kingdom of heaven is constantly referred to and alluded to. in the New Testament. If you go through it page by page by page, Jesus is constantly referring to the kingdom of heaven, trying to explain the kingdom of heaven, trying to explain it in ways that perhaps would be intelligible to the average person. Now, the kingdom of heaven, as I explained last week, is not something that is an after-death state, though it can be an after-death state. But the main thing is that when you're living here on earth, you need immediate relief. If you've got problems, if you've got things weighing you down, you want immediate relief. You can be a good boy and a good girl, but that good boy and that good girl is only going to take you past this lifetime. It is not going to take you into something where you are dealing then with areas that concern your everyday existence. So Jesus emphasized the kingdom of heaven is here and now. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. How can he say, I'm quoting from the New Testament, word for word, the kingdom of heaven is here and now, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. How could he say that if he was referring to the after death as the kingdom of heaven? The idea was the kingdom of heaven is within you. Because his words were, why lookest over here, over there? Verily I say unto you, the kingdom of heaven cometh not by observation, but the kingdom of heaven is within you. I'm quoting directly from the New Testament. So it's here and now. It's inside of you. So what do you make of that? You got to make of it, here it is. It's now. It's not the afterlife. It can be the afterlife, because what do we step into in the afterlife? We step into the extension of that consciousness, which we call the kingdom of heaven within during this physical lifetime. Psychologically, it's another portion of our unconscious mind. If you're a psychologist, that's how to approach it. Carl Jung, the greatest psychologist of the past century, referred to this as the collective unconscious, referred to it as many, many different levels of activity of mind, of consciousness taking place within every human being, whether you're conscious of it on the surface level or not. So, the first thing is, the kingdom of heaven can be an after-death state, a la the exoteric or for the masses that you go to upon cessation of physical body functions, or it can be for the immediate relief, the immediate growth, the immediate handling of your problems. It's here and now. What is that higher consciousness? It's the kingdom of God, which is also referred to in the New Testament. God exists in the kingdom of heaven. Where's the kingdom of heaven? It's inside of you. In the Bible it says, know ye not that ye are the temple of the living God? Know ye not, ye are the temple of the living God. So this body that looks back at us when we stare in a mirror each and every day is a reflection of that which houses the spirit, the mind, the intelligence which created every star in the heavens, created every planet, created every life form that exists. The beauty of this whole thing is that it exists in you. It exists in every human being, be they conscious of it or not. For the majority of those that will call themselves Christians, they are not really conscious of it in the mystical sense, which is what the secret teaching was that Jesus taught the disciples. So I'm going to thumb through here some of the New Testament and bring out some things that should be emphasized. It says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Well, when are they going to see God? In the afterlife? Possibility. Or, if the kingdom of heaven is here and now, and God is in the kingdom of heaven, here and now. What that sets up is for those people that have studied mysticism. Mysticism is union with God. The mind merger of your personal mind with the infinite or the universal mind or intelligence of God. It means that while we're still in physical embodiment, here and now, in a state of heavenly consciousness, during a state of meditation, or occasionally, spontaneously, A person may have this experience of this field of light in which they are inseparable from the field of light. Generally, when a person has a vision, as an example, in a spiritual sense, they retain their sense of identity. So you're one thing, and the vision that you're seeing spiritually is something else. That's what we call an I-thou experience. You still retain yourself, but what you're seeing is something else. In the experience of Christ consciousness, it is a state of mind where you suddenly become in a Christed state of consciousness yourself, and as this happens to you, all that exists is one infinite field of light. And you, instead of looking at the light, are the light. Hence the words, the Father and I are one. Now some people will say, well, that just referred to Jesus. No, Jesus manifested the Christ mind. And in manifesting the Christ mind, he also alluded that all of you could manifest the same thing. It was a role model, as it were, to the disciples. He carried this to perhaps an extreme. He said, "Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect." Now, that's quite an admonition for anybody that's in any type of self-help program, any type of motivational program. Imagine the person says, "Hey, be perfect as God." Now, if you attribute absolute perfection to what you consider God to be, that's really something. It's saying, and these were Christ's words, "Be ye perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." It's saying, let's not play games. Let's not go halfway. Let's be as perfect as God inside of you is perfect. And then let not your light be hidden behind a bushel, but instead let your light so shine before men, meaning let the perfection that you contain within yourself so shine before others that they may see your good works. What does that mean? It means that God is really in charge. God is the doer. Why do I say that? Because part of the secret is, which is hardly ever brought out in traditional exoteric Christianity, where Jesus said, "Why call me good?" When someone tried to compliment on miracles, good things that he did, "Why callest me good? It's not I, but the Father which doeth these good works." It is not I, not Jesus. Get that through your heads. It is not I, not Jesus. It is the Father living within me that does all of these things. I of myself, direct quote, do nothing. So think about that. There is a power in you, a power that is Christ in you, a power that is God in you, that can do and handle what your life needs to have done and to be handled in your life. That's a marvelous thought when you stop to think about it. You contain that same power. That is fantastic if you stop and consider it. It says, "But unto thy Father which seeth in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." Where is this secret place? Twice in the same verse, the secret. Where is this secret place? The secret place is inside of you. That's what makes it so secret. Think about that. If you wanted to hide something, the best place to hide it is inside of you. So what are we really? We're manifestations of the universe made flesh and bone. We are literally the spirit made flesh. When we become aware of this, we become aware of it in the Christ level of consciousness within our minds, where we recognize that we are one with this level. Now there's a verse that goes, "For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. The light of the body is the eye, and if therefore thine eye be single, thy body shall be filled with light. If thine eye be single." Now, in traditional exoteric Christianity, that would be taken as just being symbolical. But in the secret teaching, that is taken literally. If thine eye be single, what is a single eye? A single eye is the mind. The mind, really, medically even, is the only true organ of sight. So, if thine eye be single, that doesn't mean two eyes now, it means one eye, and the eye is the mind, thy body shall be filled with light. Well, there are some people that insist upon taking the Bible literally, word by word. In this case, they take it more to be symbolical. But the reality is that our body, on a God level, on a creative God level, is a field of light. So where you're sitting, all of you today, if we could really take you to a God level, what you'd see there is a shaft of light. That's what you are. You're a sitting shaft of light is what you are. Each leg is like a shaft of light. Each arm is like a shaft of light. Each finger is like a shaft of light. And yet all of this light is inseparable from the main light. So if your eye be single, if you're going into yourself, then that's it. It's very, very interesting when I consider what I've seen in motivational seminars and studies over the past recent decades, that there's so much emphasis placed upon you got to keep thinking something, you got to keep saying something, you got to keep concentrating on something to make it happen. It's very, very interesting that Jesus' words are the complete opposite of how to go about meeting your needs. And all of you are familiar with this. You've heard it. Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature? So you can think yourself silly. It isn't going to make any difference. Because you are what you already are. You are literally the kingdom of God. You are the presence of God made manifest. The main thing is to accept the presence, be the presence, live the presence, and all your needs will be taken care of. That's why he goes on to say, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow and they toil not, and yet they spin. Neither do they spin. So what he's referring to here is the mind. The mind on an intellectual level can spin around, do all of these mental, intellectual gymnastics, trying to figure out how you're going to pay your bills, how are you going to get love in your life, how are you going to preserve love in your life, how you're going to get healed. And he said, relax. He says, therefore, take no thought what we shall eat, or what we shall drink, or wherever we shall be clothed. For after all of these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth you have need of all of these things. If God lives within each and every person, isn't God aware that you need clothing on your back, you need a roof over your head, you need transportation, you need a healthy body? Of course, the God presence inside of you is aware of these things. So what's the advice? Keep saying things to yourself, repetitions. Those will only work if you are connected and it is intended to be. So what follows that verse is, but first seek ye the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. Seek first the kingdom of God, heaven within yourself, and all things shall be added unto you. So what does this mean? It means stop knocking yourselves out intellectually. Stop going to these motivational seminars that keep telling you got to keep thinking and thinking and think. Relax. Be as the lilies of the field. They don't think as we ordinarily think of thought, and yet they grow. They're taken care of. Their earthly life's voyage is taken care of. Everything in nature, whether it grows from the ground or it descends from up above, is part of the ebb and flow of universal life, part of the ebb and flow of nature. If we begin to sense this, if we begin to feel this, we begin to move with the ebb and the flow and the natural course of nature and what is taking place. Then, in that ebb and that flow, we go into ourselves, into states of meditation, which is what Jesus taught the disciples about seeing these things that other people haven't seen. They saw into themselves as Jesus had seen into himself. And as you make contact with this inner kingdom, a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing begins to take place. The unconscious, containing this heavenly awareness, this heavenly wisdom, begins to surface and influence your conscious thinking, your conscious motivation, your conscious direction in life. And it positions you to be in the right place at the right time with the right person or persons under the right conditions to be able to receive what it is you need in your life. Jesus said you can't take the kingdom of heaven by force, but you can be as little children and enter in. It's almost a childish-like acceptance, not childish in a naive sense, but a childlike expectancy that inside of each and every one of you, you contain this power that knows what you have need of. And you turn it over to that power. Whenever the temptation is to start to knock yourself out, to really go at it in the motivational sense, step back and say, no, there's an old metaphysical expression that goes, I let go and I let God. I of myself will do nothing. To the God presence within me that knows exactly what I need, you're in charge. You take over. You know exactly what I have need of. And I accept. I am in a receptive state of consciousness and of mind. So all you have to do is to be receptive. He warns the disciples, because the secreter the teaching, the more the sense of criticism. He says, give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast your pearl before the swine, lest they trample you under their feet. And at the same time, ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. What is he talking about? Let me repeat. You try to figure out what he's just saying. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened to you. Knock, what's going to be opened? What am I seeking? What am I trying to find? He's alluding not to anything in the exterior world. He's alluding to knock upon the door of our mind. Seek it within this secret place within yourself, and then it will be open to you, meaning your mind will open up with your eyes closed in a state of meditation. Your inner sight will open beyond the physical five senses, and you will see things that the disciples saw. For everyone that asketh and receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be open. What does that mean? It means that if you seek really the presence of God, literally, not from a teacher, not from a minister, not from a guru, not from a so-called saint, but if you seek it within yourself, God knows you're seeking that presence. Obviously. The presence of the universe knows exactly what's going on with you, every single thought of your life. Good thoughts, bad thoughts, inspired thoughts, degrading thoughts, everything is known. We wonder sometimes at computers nowadays and how much they're able to do. Think if you had eternity to build up an enormous system of where you create life forms and you program these life forms and you keep a connection with all your life forms. That's what you are. That's what I am. We have been created by a supreme intelligence who, for as we stumble through to try to find out and discover all of this, we're calling it DNA, we're calling it a lot of other things nowadays, we're alluding to quantum physics, we're trying to put all of these magical pieces together. But simply put, there's a supreme intelligence that has had eternity to work with. If we have come so far in empirical sciences in so few years to be able to do the marvelous things that computers do. Look at these systems and cars nowadays that lead you as far as where you need to go. When you're driving, a voice comes on and says, "No, you made the wrong turn. You got to go back two blocks." Here's a little gadget that's directing you all over this country. You start off in a certain location, you program in where you want to go, and that's it. It takes over. A little gadget that you can hold into your hands has all of this knowledge. And this little gadget has been created within the last couple of decades. Consider if you had eternity to work with, and consider if you were creating life forms and programming the life forms and thus being in touch with the life forms. General Motors, as an example, has OnStar system where if your car is stolen, you can trace where the car is. This is pretty crude in terms of the technology that is available now, because that was available years ago. So if the car can be traced, that means that there's a connection to a main circuit board. There's a connection between every one of us to a main universal consciousness that knows exactly what road we're on, the good road or the bad road. Am I making this simple and clear to you? The just road or the unjust road? The truthful road or the lying, deceitful road? In fact, one time when Jesus was approached by someone who complained about somebody getting away with something, Jesus simply said, "Verily I say unto you, they already have their reward." You can't get away from what you are. You are part of the main circuit board of the universe. And I know when we look at all of the hundreds of millions of people on this earth, and we say, how can I be in touch, or how can something called God be in touch with me? Like a pebble of sand on a vast beach that would seem so insignificant or be swallowed up by the numbers, how could anything so vast be in touch with me? It is. We are. This is phenomenal. It is absolutely fantastic how this whole thing is set up. The psalmist said, "Ye are fearfully and wonderfully made." Now, put what I just said against that backdrop. Ye are fearfully and wonderfully made. My God, you are universally engineered. Use common sense. If you just use an ounce of common sense, you'll see that what I'm saying here makes sense without reading anything into it, without trying to be self-serving as human beings versus the entirety of the universe and the cosmos. Isn't it wonderful? Isn't it wonderful that you, that would seem so insignificant by comparison to hundreds of millions of people all around you on this globe, and God knows throughout this universe, all of the life forms that exist, it's fantastic. It is absolutely fantastic, because the fantastic part is, if you can accept that, accept then that if you seek this kingdom of heaven, if you seek the main circuit board inside of yourself, that all other things that you need will be added to you because you're part of the power. That's how it works. You become one with the power through your meditations. You don't pray for things, you pray for God. You don't ask for things, you ask for God. Knowing that God is the main circuit board. God is that which the entirety of the universe has been plugged into and is plugged into your unconscious mind. You see how the power that you actually have inside of you, the power to heal, the power to love, the power to create, the power to be an entrepreneur, the power to be a creative artist, whether it's music, painting, the power to exceed in athletics, because that spirit is so driven inside of you. It's phenomenal. It goes beyond, it shrinks down our mental capacity of saying so less about ourselves. Now, there is one thing besides meditation that's necessary to get to this power. And quoting Jesus' words, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven," meaning entering into this higher state of heavenly consciousness, "shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." He that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Think about this. Not your personal will, not the will of the corporation, not the will of this person, not the will of that person, not the will of a religion, not the will of a guru, not the will of a minister, not the will of a rabbi, not the will of an alatoya, not any of these things. The will of God within yourself. So what do? You don't say, "I seek to do the will of a teacher or a master," because Jesus warns against this. He says, "Call no one masters, myself, of course, excluded. I tricked my karma into this. But call no one. So what do? You say to yourself, all right, I'm going to meditate. I'm going to go and find this secret heavenly place within myself. I'm going to find it, and I'm going to be one with it. Each day I'm going to take time to seek the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, the presence of God, the inside of myself. But each day I have to say, not my will, my personal ego will, my personal intellect, not that will be done, but the will of God within me, who has created this body, has created consciousness in this body for the body to function with. I want to do the will of the universe. Let's put it in other terms. The will of God and the will of the universe. That's what I want to do. Because that's what we're really created to do. Each of us is created to be a manifestation, an individualization of the Christ or the God made manifest. One of us is supposed to do pictures, another one is supposed to do writing music, another one is supposed to start a business, another one is supposed to excel on an athletic field. Whatever it might be, all of you are individualized expressions. And as I pointed out last week in the epistles of Paul, where he said, ye, looking at people around him, are Christ's. Ye are Christ's. Want to take the New Testament literally? There are parts that you can take literally. Ye are Christ's. So you say to yourself, my God, I'm a Christ? Absolutely, you're a Christ. Because you have Christ consciousness inside of you. A part of your mind that is part of the mind of the infinite. But where is God? We're in the middle of God. We're in the middle of God's mind. In the Bible it says, within him we move, live, and have our being. You're moving right now. You're driving down the freeway. That freeway exists in God's mind. You're on the planet Earth. The planet Earth exists in God's mind. All of you dream at night. Where do your dreams exist? In your inner sight, during dream states, you see images, you see forms, you see conversations. Think that your mind is like now a miniaturized mind of God, who sees images within God's mind, who sees planets within God's mind, and that's where we are, in God's mind. But the beauty of the whole thing is that God's mind is in us, because we are inseparable from the stuff or the light of the Creator or the Christ. When you begin to think like this, when you begin to get the vibe of what I'm saying, there's an energy connected to this. This isn't just a dry intellectual study, a philosophical study. This is the living Word. And you are the Word. Inside of you, there's another mystery. And God was the Word, and the Word was God. Everything that exists, even language, originates in the divine mind of God. And there is a word that if you were to enter into the Holy of Holies, the secret place within yourself, you would become that word. There's an actual word. And you see it and you become one with it in a higher state of consciousness. This is what the disciples were treated to. This is the thing that each of you contain hidden inside of you, that secret place of the Most High. This isn't the outer, this is the inner. This is the complete message of Jesus. For those that graduate up level by level to be able to comprehend the subtleties of what I'm talking about. Because these are subtleties. Some of these things may insult the intellect, because the intellect has its limitations. I'm sure all of you can agree upon that. The intellect has its limitations. But in the hands of infinite intelligence, your intellect suddenly becomes unlimited. So the choice is yours. Where do you think great artists get their inspiration from? Where do you think child prodigies suddenly seem to have all of this knowledge from? It's coming from the mind of the universe, from God inside of themselves. The thing is to get into a state of divine remembrance, as I've tried to put it so many times to people. Divine remembrance. To reawaken. As it says in the New Testament in one verse, the maid is not dead, but merely sleepeth. So you can sleepwalk through life thinking, I'm only a human being, I'm only an intellect. Or you can do and have the spiritual audacity to do, to call yourself a living Christ. But when you do that, you've got to then portray it. You can't be going around using all kinds of profanities, being all kinds of, having all kinds of hate fits, being envious, being deceiving. Can't do it. Because the nature of goodness has taken over. You've become the light that you are. That doesn't mean that you suddenly walk around with your hands in a pious position. Because those are the people that are most to be suspect. Jesus put it very simply, beware of ravenous wolves in sheep's clothing. Beware of those that like to walk down the street and be called, Hail Rabbi! Hail Rabbi! Are those that may be seen of men, praying in the synagogues. Now, I'm not picking on Judaism here when I'm using the synagogues, because a lot of Christian churches would be, if you have the personage of Jesus look in on things as they are today, you might get the same reaction. You might get the tables overturned in a bingo parlor that exists in some churches. Those are a few ideas, a really few wonderful ideas. The wonderful idea is that we exist in God and God exists in us, and that if we meditate each day, seeking this kingdom of heaven within ourselves, opening the single eye of our soul that we can look in and become one with this light, every day dedicating our body, our being, our mind, our souls to the will of the universe that is God within us and surrounding us, that all things will take care of themselves, so that we can be in our own right as the lilies of the field. I'm going to ask now, if you would you sit back in your chairs, put both feet flat on the floor, and let's take a few moments to enter into a state of higher consciousness, to seek that kingdom of heaven within ourselves. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit, to leave the physical skies behind me, that I may enter into the innermost sky of my own mind, a sky of awareness without beginning and without ending. And so I reverse my mind in upon itself. I turn my outer senses inward, that the energy that I use for sight and sound is now energizing the inner senses of my soul, that I may perceive the sight of the kingdom of heaven within myself. That higher state of consciousness that dwells in me as I dwell in it. A higher reality, a higher state of beingness, of consciousness. That state that is within me, right here, right now. I am in that awareness, and the awareness of the universe is in me. Right here, right now. Every breath that I breathe into my body is a breath that in actuality is breathed by the spirit of eternal life within me. For the eternal presence of God has given me breath, given my body life, given my body a soul, an eternal part of me that was before this body was and will be long after this body is no more. A higher state of consciousness and awareness. And my mind opens and expands to this consciousness, to this awareness. And I feel the entirety of my inner being being filled with the life of spirit, with light, with a consciousness of God Almighty throughout my body, my being, my mind, my awareness. That I reside in the house and the temple of God and the Most High. That where I am, my mind is Christed with an awareness of my oneness with God. Here within me, as I dwell within God's mind dwells within me. A few moments I sit in peace, feeling the great serenity of the peace of God filling my body, that my body is glorified as a temple, a synagogue, a church, a cathedral of the Most High. Feeling this now, I will retain this feeling, this sensing of this greater presence within me. And though in a few moments when I open my eyes and my senses once again to the exterior world, I will continue to be under the influence of the higher consciousness of God and the universe living within me. Dwelling in the kingdom of heaven within me as I dwell within God's mind. And I will retain this Christed sense of consciousness of my oneness with all of life universal. And so now, ever so slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes. And as I open my eyes, I'll stretch my arms and my hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars of the heavens, of universal life and mind, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the security and the peace that this is so. And so it is.